Guys, open your Bibles to Matthew chapter 5. We're going to continue our study in the book of Matthew. And a big part of my time here, we've really focused in on the Pauline epistles, and now we're starting to get into what would be considered the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the scriptures of the prophets. And understanding our mystery that's revealed in the Pauline epistles as to the creation of the body of Christ in the heavenly realm, it starts shining light on the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the scriptures of the prophets. And so this morning, I really don't even know how I'm going to really convey this to you. We're going to get very dispensational in Matthew chapter 5. Specifically as it pertains to the kingdom of heaven and what your calling and election is in Jesus Christ. We were chosen in Christ before the foundation of the world, Ephesians 1:4. Yep. Paul says that God hath saved us and called us with a holy calling according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ before the world began. You better get off your puffed up high horses, get off your dispensational charts, and start learning why God purchased you with blood and baptized you into the body of his son, Jesus Christ. And start getting ready. And start exercising yourself unto godliness and start learning how to think the way God wants you to think. The Bible said, be ye transformed by the... How do you think? Amen. We got a calling. Now, before we get into that, we're ready now to get into the meat of Matthew's gospel. Matthew's gospel is primarily presenting Jesus Christ as the King of the Jews. Each of the gospels have their own specific purpose in dealing with the Lord Jesus Christ. And Matthew is the most Jewish of the Gospels. It only takes his genealogy from Abraham to David down to Jesus Christ. Luke takes him all the way back to Adam, dealing with him as the Son of Man. Right here, Genesis begins with him, or Matthew begins with him as the son of Abraham, son of David. And here he is. We are getting into the meat of this gospel and the earthly ministry of Jesus Christ as the King of the Jews and his rejection by the nation of Israel. They rejected him. Amen? Now, back here in Matthew chapter 3, John the Baptist tells Israel that when the one who's greater than him comes, that his fan is going to be in his hand and he will thoroughly purge his floor. So what's Christ coming to do? He's coming to purge his floor. Now you got to understand a little bit about harvesting wheat to understand what John the Baptist is talking about here. But he's got a fan, a willowing fan, to purge his floor and gather his, see that? His what? Remember the parable of the wheats and tares? What happens with the wheat? What happens with the tares? John the Baptist said when he comes, he's going to gather his wheat into the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. You know what Jesus Christ is coming to do? He's coming to purge the nation of Israel. Some people are going into the garner and some people's going into the fire. But he's going to thoroughly purge it. When he's done, you're not going to be able to find a piece of chaff anywhere in his floor. Now, the garner here is his kingdom. He's gathering some people into the kingdom, and others are going to be burned up with unquenchable fire. Remember Matthew 10? I've not come to bring peace, but the sword. To set father against mother and mother-in-law at variance with her daughter. You know what he's saying? He's saying, I've come to divide the nation. He said, my sword is so sharp and this, this purging and this division is going to be so fine that it's going to separate families. Yes, sir. For how long? Eternity. If any man, what did he say? If any man cometh after me and loveth mother and father and more than me, he's not worthy of me. What are we talking about? We're talking about a purging of Israel. The separation of wheat from the chaff. Separate, it's going to be so fine that it's going to divide families. Paul said in Romans 9:21 about God's dealing with Israel. This is not about you. These Calvinists come to Romans chapter 9, they think the election there is a man for salvation. He's talking about the election of Israel. And he says, hath not the potter power over the clay of the same lump? What lump's he talking about? Israel. And he said, does the potter not have power of that to take that same lump of clay and make a vessel unto honor and another unto dishonor? That's what God did in the earthly ministry of Christ. He made an Israel of honor and an Israel of dishonor. It's what Christ come to do. Amen? Look at Malachi chapter 3, right after the... Now notice this is John the Baptist preaching here. Malachi 3:1 is a prophecy about John. I send my messenger before me. He shall prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek shall suddenly come to his temple, even the messenger of the covenant, even the Lord whom you delight in. Now look at what he says in Malachi 3:2 here. Look at this. But who may abide the day of his coming? And who shall stand when he appeareth? For he is like a what? What does a refiner's fire do? It comes to purge dross out of precious metal. You know how you refine gold and silver? You take it and you put it in a crucible. You put that thing in the fire and get that metal turned to liquid, and then you pull it out and you start scraping all the impurities out of it. Then you put it back in the fire. You scrape more. You put it back in the fire. You scrape more. After about 7 times, you start pulling that metal out. If you pick up gold, you can't see your reflection in it. Then when you purify all the dross out of it, as you purify it, you begin to be able to see your own reflection in that piece of gold. Amen? Christ is coming as a refiner's fire. What does that mean? He's going to purge all the dross out of the nation of Israel. And he is like fuller's soap. What does soap get out? Dirt. So what's he saying? Is he saying who's going to be able to abide the day of his coming because he's coming to purge out the dross and wash out all the filth? You understand what Christ come to do? Now this all pertains to the nation of Israel in his coming. And if you understand that, you're going to understand a little bit about his earthly ministry. You're going to understand what's taking place. You're going to understand why he teaches a parable called the wheats and tares and talks about the children of the kingdom and the children of the wicked one and to let both grow together. There's coming a day of purging. He says, let both grow together, and then at the time we'll gather the wheat and then we'll gather the tares. You ever read Revelation 14? Two sickles go in the earth, don't they? Mm-hmm. Have I left you already? Okay. Keep up. I know most people today open up a Bible for 10 minutes in church, get a little devotional, and then they go home and feel very religious and pious about themselves. We don't do that here. We believe in this book too much. Man lives by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. And so knowing that Christ, what he came to do was to purge the nation, his public ministry begins in chapter 5 and ends in chapter 24. It begins, look at this, seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him. Look how it ends. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him. His ministry begins and ends with him set on a mountain teaching his disciples. Amen? You think that's just a coincidence, don't you? It's not. You know what the primary message of Matthew 5 through 7 is? The primary message of Matthew chapter 5 through 7 is the righteousness they got to have in order to enter into the kingdom of heaven. That's it. He tells them, except your righteousness exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you shall in no case enter the kingdom of heaven. Yeah. What's he doing? He's purging the nation. You know how his public ministry ends? Woe unto you scribes and Pharisees. You got to have a righteousness that exceeds that, and his ministry ends with him speaking woes unto the scribes and Pharisees and says, how can you escape the damnation of hell? They're not going to enter. You know the first thing he says to them? You shut up the kingdom of heaven against men. For ye yourselves enter not in, neither suffer ye them that are entering to enter in. You generation of you serpents, you generations of vipers, how can you escape the damnation of hell? Where are they going? They're going in the fire.
Yep, sure are.
Woe unto them. You with me? That's the beginning and end of his ministry. Y'all, look at Matthew 7. The conclusion of the Sermon on the Mount. Look at what he says. Now we're going to get into some dispensational teaching, guys, about how this stuff, how we as the body of Christ are to understand and to read these things. But look at Matthew 7:24. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended. Corn talked about it this morning. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. That's how he concludes his Sermon on the Mount. His Sermon on, you know what he's saying? He said, the things I just said is going to have a twofold effect. Those who hear it and do it are going to be like wise men that are built upon a rock, and those who hear them and do them not are going to be like fools that build a house upon a sand. And the same event is going to come. The rains are going to descend. The floods are going to come. The wind's going to beat. One house is going to fall and another one's going to stand. Purging of the nation. That means there's a time coming that's going to try that nation. You ever read James to the 12 tribes scattered abroad? Trial of faith. You ever read Peter to the stranger scattered about, the trying of your faith being more precious than of gold that perisheth, that it may be found in the praise, honor, and glory at the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. You ever read Peter over there? He says, God make you that, he said, God establish you and make you after you've suffered a while, make you perfect. So there's a time coming, Christ is saying, this is the righteousness you have to enter the kingdom. And if you will hear what I'm saying and do it, you're going to be like this. But if you hear it and don't do it, your fall is going to be great. All right, y'all got that? That's how his public ministry begins. How's it end? It ends with his disciples coming to him privately after he told them about a coming destruction of Jerusalem. A coming time of wrath. Christ said in Luke 21 that when you see Jerusalem compassed with armies, then is going to be a time of great wrath upon this people.
Yep. Amen.
Amen. Yeah. His disciples say, when? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? You know what Christ tells him? Now remember, we're talking about the purging of the nation. You know what he tells them? Verse 5, many are going to be deceived. Take heed that you're not one of them, he says. Because many are going to come in my name saying, I'm Christ, and shall deceive many. Before Christ comes, many are going to be deceived, he said. Do you know what he says down there a little bit further? He says, then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and many shall be offended and shall betray one another. You know what Christ is saying? The last days is going to see a very deceived people that are easily offended. We're getting there. We're getting there. Amen? Most people couldn't handle a church service like this. You know it. Then he tells them, not only is many going to be offended, he said many false Christs, many false prophets are going to come and shall deceive what? Many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. What is that? It's a bunch of people that heard his words and didn't do them.
Yeah, there you go.
And they're going to get deceived. They're going to get offended. They're going to be deceived, and they're going to their love is going to wax cold. Amen. Amen. Then you know what he tells them? That there's going to come a time of great tribulation before his return to gather his elect. Now get this. He will gather what? But he tells them that prior to his coming together, his elect, there's going to be a time of great tribulation. That's the descending rains and the floods and the wind that is going to come and beat upon the house and determine whether it's founded upon a rock or upon the sand. Y'all with me? Now, you want to understand that beating upon the house? That wind, remember what the writer of Hebrews said? See then that you refuse not him that speaketh. For if they escape not him that spoke from the earth, how shall you escape if you refuse him that speaketh from heaven? Whose voice then shook the earth, but now once more he hath promised, shake I not the earth only, but the heavens also. This word once more yet signifieth the removing of the things that are shaken, that the things which cannot be shaken may remain. Wherefore we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved. You getting it? That shaking is removing things that are shook, that the things which cannot be shaken may remain. That's what's built upon the rock and what's built upon the sands. And the ones built upon the rock are the ones who don't refuse him that speaketh from heaven.
Amen.
You getting it? Now, not only that, we may not even get into the dispensational aspect of this morning. But not only that, note that his public ministry begins with blessings and ends with woes. Matthew 5, blessed, 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 blessed. Matthew 23, woe, 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 woe. Purging of the nation. You understand in the earthly ministry of Jesus Christ now. He's purging a nation. Amen? Y'all understanding it? Who's the woe spoken against? Woe unto you, Pharisees, scribes, hypocrites. Who did he tell this people? Whose righteousness did he tell them that they had to have a righteousness that exceeds in order to enter the kingdom of heaven? That means the scribes and the Pharisees ain't going in. And their righteousness has to be greater than these guys over here. You know what he tells these people here? I've already quoted the verse, ye serpents, ye generation of vipers, and then you people act like you don't know what the synagogue of Satan is in the book of Revelation. You'll go Google it. You'll buy books from Christian bookstores. You'll search everywhere in the world except the King James Bible to try to locate the synagogue of Satan, and it's staring you in the face all through that Bible.
Yep.
You know what he calls them in Isaiah chapter 1? You know what he calls them? Ye rollers of Sodom. Yep. What's Jerusalem called in spirit? Sodom and Egypt. You ever read Deuteronomy 32 about the poison of Sodom and all that stuff? Mm-hmm. People act like they don't know what the synagogue of Satan is. The synagogue of Satan is a bunch of political Zionists that have rejected the Lord Jesus Christ and are going to build a temple over there that doesn't have Christ in it. And the one that's going to sit in that thing is Satan himself, who exalt himself above all that is called God and his worship. You act like you don't know what the synagogue of Satan is. It's this group right here. They're called the children of the wicked one, a generation of vipers. The devil planted them there. Who planted the tares? There you go. If you can't get the answers of the King James Bible, don't even bother anywhere else.
Amen. Read. Yep.
Amen. Oh, it's mean, preacher. No, it's not. God gave us a book so that we can understand his will, and people just play games with it. I mean, this stuff right here, this is so perfectly structured. Guys, you know that it's structured perfectly. You see it. He begins on a mountain, he ends on a mountain. He begins with blessing and ends with woes. And now let's consider these comparisons. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is what? First woe, they shut up the kingdom of heaven. Poor in spirit are going to get the kingdom of heaven. These men are shutting up the kingdom of heaven because they're not going in. And they don't want anybody else going in. Blessed are ye that mourn, for ye shall be comforted. What's the second woe? Those who devour widows' houses. A widow would be one who mourns, and these guys over here are devouring them. These are going to be comforted. These are going to receive the greater damnation. Y'all seeing that stuff? Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit what? These are proselytes that are made twofold more the child of hell. They're unfit for the earth. The proselytes of the Pharisees are twofold more the children of hell than they themselves. These people over here get the earth. Those people over there are children of hell. Blessed are ye that do hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be. These right here are blind guides. They can't lead anybody to righteousness. They care more about the gold of the temple than the temple itself, and they care more about the sacrifice than the altar. They know nothing about righteousness. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain what? These guys omitted the weightier matters of the law. Judgment, mercy, and faith. They omitted mercy and judgment, faith. These people are merciful. These right here omitted it. You with me?
Yeah.
Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see what? You Pharisees and hypocrites, you cleanse the outside of the cup, and the inside is full of excess and extortion. These here are pure in heart. These right here only care about the outside. They don't care about the inward cleanliness.
It's good.
Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. These people over here are inside full of hypocrisy and iniquity. Blessed are ye when ye are persecuted for my name's sake. Great is your reward in heaven. These guys here, Christ said, I send unto you prophets. He says, you've taken the ones that I've sent to you and you've stoned them and you've scourged them. You've crucified them. There's the persecuted. Great is their reward in heaven. There's the persecutors of those people. And what do they get? They get the avenging of the blood from Abel all the way to Zechariah. Going to fall upon them. These people get a great reward in heaven. These people get the blood of the righteous avenged upon their heads. Mm-hmm.
Wow.
You ever read over there about the devil casting some of them into prison and they will be tried 10 days? Who do you think the devil is? It's this group right here. Amen. The devil always likes to wear holy things too. You know that? Holy hats and holy breastplates and set holy temples. And then when he gets you to kill God's people, he has people think that they're doing God's work. Mm-hmm. Y'all with me? Now, Matthew 5:20. Well, sorry, I already quoted that verse. Matthew 5:2. When he was set and his disciples came unto him, I love this passage. I love that passage. You know what the Bible says about the mouth of this man? You know what the Bible says about it? It is most sweet. His mouth is most sweet. Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth, for thy love is better than wine. Amen? You love the mouth of the Lord? And I love it most when it's opened. Amen? I don't like when God closes his mouth. I don't like when he's silent. I like when he speaks. Remember Mary and Martha over there? Oh, man, we might not get anywhere this morning. Remember Mary and Martha? Martha's over there, you know, just busy, grumbling and complaining. Good, godly, dedicated, independent fundamentalist, busy, 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 complaining the whole time. Mary's at his feet. Martha's complaining about where Mary is. She should be over here helping. You know what Christ tells her? He says she chose the better part, and what she's chosen shall not be taken from her. She was sitting at the feet of Christ waiting for him to open his mouth and talk. Amen? Most important thing in this world is to love God. He opened his mouth and taught them, saying. Now you see that open mouth there? Deuteronomy 18, God told Israel that I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren like unto thee, a prophet like unto Moses, and will put my words in his what? There he is. There's the prophet. God put his words in his mouth and he opened his mouth. I will put my words in his mouth and he shall speak unto them all that I shall command him. And it shall come to pass that whosoever will not hearken unto my words, which he shall speak in my name, I will require it of him. That's the main gist of the book of Hebrews. God hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord? Whatever people in the nation of Israel doesn't hearken to the words that come out of this man's mouth, God's going to require it of them. Amen? So what we're about to read, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, very, very important scriptures, aren't they? Those are the words God put in his mouth to speak unto them. Right? Now, when you start breaking down the Sermon on the Mount, guys, the way the world uses the Sermon on the Mount has caused a lot of the brethren to kind of shy away from it.
It's true.
The Sermon on the Mount is one of the greatest sermons ever preached on this earth.
Amen.
When you read it, you will not find a greater righteousness being preached than what's being preached in Matthew 5, 6, and 7. And you say, but we're not Israel. Right is right and wrong is wrong. I don't care what dispensation you're in.
Amen.
If you got a heart that only cares what men see instead of what God sees, you're evil.
Go ahead, brother.
I don't care if you're in the body of Christ. I don't care. If you got a heart that don't care about what God sees inwardly, you're evil.
Amen.
Yep. End of story.
Amen.
You can usually tell. The ones who care about what God sees. They don't run around thinking they are something. Blessed are the poor in what? We're going to get to what that's about. They ain't running around making large their phylacteries and just like Vickers, yeah. Just like the man wouldn't even lift his eyes up. Didn't even have the audacity to look to God. Have mercy on me. Remember the man that sat with Christ at the table? The woman came in and fell at his feet and started crying. And that man said in his heart, if he knew what manner of woman this was. Christ said, I got somewhat against you. Since I came into thine house, you've offered me no water for my feet. Went on and on and on. You know what that man's doing? That man's sitting at a table with God as if he's his equal. Get on your face. That woman washed my feet with her tears, dried them with her hair. Pride's going to be the undoing of many a man. First section of the Sermon on the Mount contains the blessings, the characteristics of the people, and the reward that they're going to get. The poor in spirit, them that mourn, them that are meek. Then the second section deals with the salt and the light of the world. Very important little section there. Because something's going to be cast out and trodden under the foot of men, and something's going to be placed on a candlestick to glorify God. Get it? That means there are people in Israel who have lost their savor that are no longer good for anything but to be cast out and trodden under the foot of men. There are people in Israel who have not lost their savor, and God is going to light them and place them on a candlestick that they may give light to all that are in the house, that men may see their good works and glorify Him. Somebody's getting cast out. Somebody's getting exalted. You ever read that passage? You understand it now. Amen. Who was that? Was that Eli? Amen, Eli. Then from Matthew 5:20 to 7:23, you have Christ preaching on the righteousness of God. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and what? What do they need? They need a righteousness that exceeds the scribes and Pharisees. So Christ tells them to seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Not the kingdom of heaven. Seek first the kingdom of God. A spiritual kingdom with God's righteousness. Then God will add all the physical to them. If you want the physical blessing, you got to seek God and His righteousness first. And that chapter, those chapters are about God's righteousness. And then Matthew 7, 24 through 27 is the conclusion. Three chapter sermon that Christ tells them, if you hear these words and do them, you will be like a man that builds his house on a rock. And if you hear them and ignore them, you're going to be like a man built on the sand. Then he goes about his day. That's how we got to be with the Word of God. The Word of God is going to do what it does. Amen? You just got to preach it. Now, y'all bear with me for a few here. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. You see that? Blessed are the who? What does he mean by that? Look at Isaiah 66. You know what Isaiah 66 is about? It's about creation. And God's rest. Corin talked about it this morning. Heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. What house will you build for me, or where is the place of my rest? For all those things hath mine hand made, and all those things have been, saith the Lord. But to this man will I look, even to him that is what? And of a contrite spirit, and trembleth at my word. You know what God just said? He said, I've made all these things. You can't build nothing for me. He said, but this is what I'm looking for.
Yeah.
I'm looking to dwell with them that are poor and contrite and tremble at my word.
Amen,
you don't think that's about your dispensation too?
Right.
You think God don't know those who tremble at his book and who don't?
Amen. That's right, brother.
You don't think God takes note of those who have stained their Bibles with tears and who hasn't? You don't think God has taken note of the men who the Word of God has caused their bones to quake and to tremble? Because He has. To this man will I look, even to him that is poor and of a contrite spirit and trembleth at my word. Not the man getting up, correcting it.
Come on.
You think a man that gets up and says, that's wrong, that's an error, a better way of saying it, or this should say, you think that man trembles? He ain't trembling at anything. He's correcting God. He's talking like the serpent in Genesis 3. That's who God's looking for. He's looking to dwell with those kind of people. When it says the tabernacle of God is with men and he will dwell with them and he will be their God and they shall be his people, those are the people he's talking about. You want proof? For thus saith the high and lofty one that inhabiteth eternity, whose name is holy, I dwell in the high and holy place. With who? With him also that is of a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite ones.
Amen.
Who does God dwell with? Who does he dwell with? The contrite and the humble spirit.
Amen.
He resisteth the proud, giveth grace to the humble. Amen, boys. Blessed are the poor in what? Why, theirs is the kingdom of heaven. You see the adjectives though: poor, contrite, trembleth. Look at this. Look at these adjectives here: contrite and humble. Look at here. The Lord is nigh unto them that are of a what?
Broken
heart, and saveth such as be of a contrite spirit. So when David murdered, when David took a man's wife and had him murdered, had him killed, what could David do? Was there blood he could offer for that? No. So what does David do? He tells God, if you would have wanted sacrifice and offering, I would have given it to you. He says, but the sacrifices of God are a what? A broken and contrite heart, O God, thou wilt not despise.
Amen.
You know what God did with David's sin? He took it away. Amen? Amen, guys. You know what God is looking for? You know who God is looking to? He's looking to the man who fears and trembles at his word. The man whom God's word has broken his spirit and heart. Do you know one of the purposes of that book is to break your inner man?
Amen.
One of the purposes of that book is to get inside there and break that spirit and break that heart.
Amen.
Not to always lift you up, talk about how wonderful of a person you are. Part of the purpose of that book is to go inside of there and break you.
Amen.
And to bring you to a state of absolute fear and trembling in the presence of God. When God looks down and he sees that brokenness inside of the inner man, he says, there's my sacrifices. I don't despise that. Y'all with me? God is looking toward the man whom his word has gone inside and broken and brought to a place of contrition and has brought itself in humility before God. The word gets in there, breaks your heart, breaks your spirit, brings you to a place of fear and trembling, and then brings you in humility before God. And then God can lift you up. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you. James 5. Remember, guys, this stuff's about Israel, right? We're going to get to something here just very quickly. Be afflicted. This is James writing to who? 12 tribes scattered abroad. Look what he tells them to do. Earlier in the chapter, he says, I'm sorry, that's James 4, I think, guys, sorry. Am I right? James 4:9? I just realized I made a mistake there. It's 4:9. It's 4:9. Double check me anyways. I promise it's 4:9. But earlier in the chapter, he had told them, ye adulteresses and adulterers, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Now look what he tells them to do. Be afflicted and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to what? And your joy to heaviness. You know what he's saying? The things that make you laugh, let them become the things you mourn about. The things that bring you joy, let them become your heaviness. Because the laughter of this world and the joy of this world is enmity against God. He's asking for them to get off of that path and return to him with mourning and heaviness for the things that brought them laughter and joy. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. That's prophetically Joel. The day of the Lord is at hand. Therefore also now saith the Lord, turn you even to me with all your heart, and with fasting, and with weeping, and with mourning, and rend your what? God is nigh unto them that are of a broken what? Rend your heart, not your garments. Always trying to put on a show, wasn't they? Rending their garments, putting on a show. God looked down there and said, that heart ain't broken. Rend your heart, not your garments, and turn unto the Lord your God. Do you know why Israel can't see Jesus Christ today? Because their hearts are not turned to the Lord. Paul said, when their hearts turn to the Lord, the veil that is over their heart will be done away in Christ. That's all about Israel, guys. Now, what does the poor in spirit get? And I'm going to close here with this information I'm about to give you, man, because I want to apply this to you guys. What does the poor in spirit get? The kingdom of what? James 2:5 says, hearken, my beloved brethren. Hath not God chosen the what? Now let's compare it with another verse in 1 Corinthians. The poor is nowhere in there. Look for it. See, people take a verse, they see words like chosen, and they're just like, oh, this is all the same stuff. No, it's not. What did he choose here? Of what? What did he choose here? Weak, base, despised, things that are... He mentions everything but the poor.
Yep, it's different.
But you better believe it's different. It's as different as God choosing apples and oranges. You can't say... God hath not God chosen apples, and hath God not chosen oranges, and say they're the same. The poor's not here. These things have been chosen to confound and to bring the not the things that are. God has chosen foolish, weak, base, despised things that are not right now to bring to not the things that currently are. God is choosing something right now in this world to bring this world to nothing.
Yes, sir. Right on. Well, amen.
You got it? You know when he chose us in Christ? And he's just now calling us. He chose us in him before the foundation of the world to bring to naught the things that now are. And he didn't start calling us until 2,000 years ago after his son died on a cross for us. Now watch. These people that God hath chosen, rich in faith and heirs of the what? Which he hath promised to them that what? Paul says, but as it is written, I have not seen nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath what? For them that what? They're not the same. There can't. How could God have promised a kingdom to them that love him, but ear had never heard it?
Come on, preacher, that's obvious. It's good.
Amen.
You getting it?
Yeah.
Now they're connected.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
What God prepared and kept hid is for the purpose of bringing the kingdom that he's promised them that love him.
Yes, sir. Yep. Oh, shit.
Amen, 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 amen.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all keep up now. I hadn't seen it, ear had not heard it, but God hath what? Revealed them unto who?
Us.
By his Spirit. The Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. Now, when we're talking about something prepared for them that love him, Christ tells the nations in Matthew 25, 34, to come, ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world.
Yeah.
But you know what Paul's quoting in Isaiah, in 1 Corinthians 2, he's quoting Isaiah 64. You know the first verse of Isaiah 64 is Israel saying, oh, that thou wouldest rend the heavens and come down. Oh, heavens are going to depart like what? I saw heaven, and behold, a white horse, and upon his head were many crowns. I hadn't seen that. There's something up there behind the heavens, guys, that I have not seen, ears not heard. It's been prepared. Look at Isaiah 64 and 4. Listen at this. For since the beginning of the world, men have not heard nor perceived by the ear, neither hath the eye seen, O God, beside thee. What he hath prepared for them that waiteth for him. Ephesians 3, 8 through 9 says that Paul's dispensation was to preach the unsearchable riches of Christ and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery which since the beginning hath been hid in God.
Amen.
Who created all things by Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Do you know part of that creation is invisible?
Yes.
Colossians 1:16, what did he create? For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, both visible and invisible. Whether they be thrones, dominions, principalities, or powers, all things were created by him and for him. There are thrones, dominions, and principalities in heaven created for Christ, and some in the earth created for Christ.
Yep. That's it.
You say, where are you going with all this, preacher? Well, what has I not seen and heard? I have not seen and heard what God prepared in the heavenly places. Unsearchable riches of God's Son, created for him. And then you were put into him as his bone and his flesh.
Amen.
To fill all things.
Oh, come on. Amen.
Meaning the kingdom that God has promised them that love him was always promised on the basis of what God prepared and kept hid.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yes, sir.
Do you know what that means? I'll tell you what it means. You see that verse right there? When did God choose you in Christ? And I hath not seen nor ear heard. You got it? It's like I've already said once this morning, guys. I've just been going right at an hour, man. Y'all give me time to finish this. I'm trying to close this up. Listen to me. These dispensationalists, these mid-acts people, they need to get off their puffed up high horse and get out of their charts and realize why they're in Christ. Why was blood shed for you?
Amen.
Why were you purchased?
Amen. Heart.
Amen. Yes.
Why were you bought with blood? Right. You were chosen in Christ before the foundation of the world. Paul says that God saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, yeah, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began, but now is made manifest.
Yeah. There you go, preacher. Come on.
Yeah.
We were chosen for heavenly governmental positions in the heavenly realm to bring a kingdom to this earth to them that love God. To bring a kingdom to the poor and them that mourn and them that hunger and thirst for righteousness. We were chosen in Christ for that purpose.
Thank you, God.
Now you got to walk worthy of it. You got to walk worthy of it. Do you know what the calling? Do you understand this holy calling that God gave us in Christ before the world began? Romans 8:19, for the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. The hope of creation waits for our revelation and our manifestation. Why? Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God.
Amen.
Ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. And one of these days, we are going to deliver the creation out of its current bondage and bring it into glorious liberty with us. And everything God promised the creation throughout the scriptures was waiting on this. And so there's two things groaning at this present time. The creature is groaning, waiting for the manifestation of God's sons, and God's sons are groaning within themselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of the body.
Amen.
We're waiting for that day that Christ comes and redeems his purchased possession. And when that new man is set in the heavenly realm as the fullness of God's Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, bone of his bone, flesh of his flesh, when his church and his body, when the head and the body become one in heaven, God is going to manifest that new man to the creation, and the creation is going to be delivered out of its bondage. That's how you know when you're a son. You increase in the knowledge of God. Now let me ask you something. Do you understand why Paul now tells you to put on, as the elect of God, bowels of mercies? Do you know who's been running this earth for the last 6,000 years? You ever read Psalm 82? God asked them gods, how long will you not deliver the poor and the needy? How long will you accept the persons of the wicked? How long are you going to continue to reward? That Bible says the wicked blesseth the covetous man whom the Lord abhorreth. You live in a world where covetous people are blessed. Oh, look at what he's got. What a great man. Look, he's got a boat and a big house. And we bless that stuff and God abhors it. The wicked boasteth of his heart's desire. If I set a picture of congressmen up here and I set a picture of homeless people up here, which one would you mind?
Amen. Yep. Yep. Come on.
That Bible said, mind not high things. Condescend the men of low estate. If you mind high things, if you bless the covetous, If you suppose gain is godliness, you don't think like your father thinks. God came down from the highest position and descended into the lowest parts of the earth. That's condescending. You've been called to be a son of God, and in order to function in your election of God, there's some traits God wants you to have. Bowels of mercy, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering. Not wrath, filthy communication, blasphemy, bitterness, envy, covetousness. Be transformed by the God wants you to think like He thinks. That you yourself may prove what is that good, perfect, and acceptable will of God. Christ gave Himself for us that He might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto Himself of what? Zealous of what? Let me ask you something. If you ain't excited about what God's doing today, spare me of pretending like you care what He's going to be doing after the rapture.
Amen.
Spare me.
And
while we're on the subject, all you people that want the rapture to happen any moment, it's because you don't understand what God is doing right now. You're selfish. You want God to come and get you out of your trouble because you don't care about what He's doing right now. Every day I wake up, I thank God for another day of long suffering. And I say, God, let me suffer with You. God, let me know the fellowship of Your Son's sufferings. God, use me to bring sinners to salvation and men to the knowledge of the truth.
Amen.
To abide in the flesh is more needful. The sufferings of this present time, guys, when we enter into the glory, that eternal glory is going to make this little present time seem like a drop in the bucket. Just buckle up and have a good time with what God's doing. When you get to eternity, you got it. I'll be honest with you, I'm not ready. I've not yet attained where I want to attain. I know the judgment seat of Christ might not terrify some of you. It scares me. I'm not ready. I'm ready to go to heaven. I'm saved. I'm not ready to give account of myself to God. And I also know that my rapture means the day of salvation to this world is over. And so I'm just as excited about doing what God is doing today as what He's called me to do 1,000 years from now, 2,000 years from now. Godliness has promise of life that now is and that which is to come. There's a godly life for you to live now and a godly life for you to live in the world to come. Exercise yourself unto that godliness. Psalm 82, Revelation 11, Revelation 19. One of these days, the kingdoms of this world, God is going to judge the gods in the heavenly realm. He's going to cast them down because they're corrupt. Arise, O God, and judge the earth, for Thou shalt inherit all nations. Revelation 11, 15, the seventh angel sounds. What's he doing? He's making a declaration to creation that the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our God and of His Christ, but Christ don't return to the earth for 3.5 years after that. But guess what happens in Revelation 12? Satan and his angels are cast down. But Christ has possession of the kingdoms from Revelation 11 all the way to chapter 19. And when he sees heaven open, he comes out with many crowns on his head. He's taken full possession of the kingdoms of the world. And he's called the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. In his time, he will show who is the blessed and only Pope. Why is he called the King of Kings there? He hasn't appointed a single king on the earth in Revelation 19. So where do you think them kings are? And what are they about to do? They're about to bring a kingdom to the poor and the needy and them that mourn. They're about to bring that kingdom that God promised them that love God They're about to bring that kingdom to this earth and rule the world in righteousness and love and peace, all to the glory of our Father. Being a son of God is an important thing, guys. And learning how to think the way your Father thinks is an important thing. Don't worry about the guys still trying to figure out if the Bible should say what it says. You got them. They're up in Michigan and everywhere else. Still trying to figure out if it's okay for the Bible to read a little bit different here and a little bit different there. And then wanting to worry about us talking about you getting a new mind so that you can please God and walk worthy of Him. If you want to take them people serious, you take them serious. I don't take them serious, and neither does God. You ain't going to find them doing what God is doing today. Amen, amen, amen. All right. Brother Adrian, you close us out, brother.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for the word, Lord, that was given today, Lord God. We praise you that we can understand it fully, Lord God, with full comprehension, Lord God, through your spirit, through your word, Lord God, we receive. And we do affirm and confirm your word today, Lord God. Yes. So we thank you for the fellowship that we share, the mystery, Lord God, with that was preached from the foundation of the world. And also give you thanks for what you planned before the foundation of the world in us, your body, Lord God, and you give it a name, the new creature. So we thank you for what is going on here in this fellowship, Lord God, what we're coming to understand, Lord God, and also thank you for our open hearts that we had to receive your word, Lord God, and thank you for it, Lord God, that we might grow in our inner man and be more understanding of it is that what you are doing, Lord God. So we give you praise for this day, for the message and the preacher, Lord God, and for all the souls that were able to hear and understand it. Thank you, Lord God, in this place of fellowship. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.